in Christ in Granville, New York, all the way across Vermont. And you hit New York, and that's Granville, right on the border, straddle the border. So greetings, they will be beginning their time of worship in about 15 minutes, and my best friend and fellow pastor, Brian Brett, will be preaching. And he'll be preaching on Mark. We're moving through Mark, a sermon series in Mark, and he'll be preaching on Mark 4, verses 1 to 25, which, if you know anything about Mark 4, it's all about hearing the voice of God. Disciples of Jesus hear his voice, and the parable of the sower is in there as well. So I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer in a second, and would you pray with me for us here today, and for Brian, and for the unbelievers that will most likely be there in the group that meets in one of our pastors' houses, New Creation Church, that the word would penetrate the hearts of the people there and that they would be saved. It's constant prayer. God, move. We cannot save people. So would you pray with me? Father, thank you for this opportunity to be here. Thank you that your Holy Spirit is saving sinners and sanctifying, making holy your saints, your people, all over this world, even as we speak. And I pray that you would do that here, that you would give us ears to hear this morning, that you would give us hearts to understand your word, and that you would be with Brian as he preaches, that Lord, you would work and move in the hearts and minds of those there, that they would trust in Jesus Christ, and even for the first time. And I pray that you would be with my mouth this morning as I speak, that you, Jesus, would be honored as the one who befriends sinners like us. Lord, I pray that you bless our time. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you didn't grab one on the way in, this is actually a roadmap for the sermon in one page. And it's kind of important for your tracking with where I'm going, because I'm preaching through 22 verses, which is a bit of a stretch. And so I don't want anybody to get lost, and I don't want to get lost either. So I have notes, and so raise your hand if you didn't get one, and Dave's going to be passing these out. So if you would turn in your Bibles with me to Mark chapter 2, verses 13, all the way to 3, verse 6. But you don't, if you have a Bible or you'd rather just follow along in the notes, I printed out the text in color code so you can track with the flow of the argument here on this paper. So you have the text in front of you if you get the paper. So Mark chapter 2. But before we look at those verses, I'd like to take a minute and look at the context. We'll step back and look at the context of where Mark has been so far. In the first 12 verses of chapter 2, before where we're starting, Jesus, you'll see, did something that really shocked the religious leaders of the day, called scribes. Jesus claimed to forgive sin. So all along through Mark 1, we see Jesus' authority on display. He's kicking out demons. He's healing sickness and healing diseases. He's teaching in a way that just is blowing people's minds. And they're like, we've never heard anybody talk like this. This isn't your typical run-of-the-mill rabbi when he gets up, everybody gone. No. Everybody's like, what just happened? This guy comes into the synagogue and he kicks out a demon and he's teaching in a way. And so Jesus is on display, his powerful authority. Chapter 2 hits and people are even more shocked because he claims to have authority to forgive sin. Sin that's not even against him. Son, your sins are forgiven. Who is this man? And so people are marveling at the authority of Jesus. Now, in chapter 2, verse 13, there's a shift that happens in Mark's gospel. And the rest of chapter 2 and all of chapter 3 is focused on, okay, Jesus has authority. Now, What does it mean to follow Jesus? Who are these disciples of Jesus? So it's focusing on who are the disciples of Jesus in chapters 2 and 3, and who are not the disciples of Jesus. Who aren't Jesus' followers? And here's a hint. It's the Pharisees. And that's what we're going to be looking at today. Who are not the disciples of Jesus? Now, a long section, 22 verses. So, unfortunately, we won't be able to go quite as deep into each of the stories that we're going to look at this morning. But it's really important to read them all together, because what we're going to see is that there's four stories that make a sandwich around three parables. Now, if you know anything about sandwiches, you call a sandwich by what's in the middle, right? It's not like a sourdough sandwich, or, you know, it's a roast beef sandwich, or a ham sandwich, or a turkey sandwich. I mean, meat is in the middle. And Mark loves sandwiches. He uses them all throughout his gospel, again and again and again and again. A good study Bible, if you read through Mark, they'll point a lot of them out. And we're still even discovering new ones today. I mean, that's just a writing style that he used. And I'll explain kind of how it works in a minute, but in the middle is always where the good stuff is. Of course, it's all good. But in the middle is where he really packs his main point. So in your colored handout today, what's going on is you've got a sandwich. The blue and the red are like the bread of the sandwich, okay? And the black in the middle is like the meat. Now, the top blue corresponds to the bottom blue. In the top blue and bottom blue, Jesus does something that shocks the Pharisees. In the red, the disciples do something that shocks the Pharisees. And in the middle, you have Jesus' interpretation of what's going on in the parables that he tells. So I'm going to read through this passage, point out a few things as we go, and then give you my main idea, and we'll start working through it more slowly. So here's the read through. First, you got the blue. Jesus does something that shocks the Pharisees. Once again, Jesus went out beside the lake. A large crowd came to him, and he began to teach them. As he walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. "Follow me," Jesus told him. And Levi got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." Now Jesus' disciples do something that shocked the Pharisees in verse 18. Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. Some people came and asked Jesus, "How is it that John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees are fasting, but yours are not?" We'll look at this later in a minute, but here you've got the middle. Now Jesus gives an explanation for what's going on. And this is where the main idea is. Here's the main idea, and I'll say it again in a minute, so if you don't get it, you know, don't worry. Jesus is the bridegroom who has come and brought wine for sinners that the Pharisees can't handle. That's basically his answer. "I'm the bridegroom, I've come, and I brought wine, and you guys can't handle it." Alright? Now, he unpacks that with three parables. Parable 1. How can the guests of the bridegroom fast while he is with them? They cannot, so long as they have him with them. Verse 20. "But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them, and on that day they will fast." Parable 2. Verse 21, "No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. Otherwise, the new piece will pull away from the old, making the tear worse." Parable 3, verse 22, "No one pours new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and both the wine and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wineskins." Now back out into the bread part of the sandwich. That was the meat in the middle. Now you see another story where Jesus' disciples do something that shocks the Pharisees. Verse 23, "One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as his disciples walked along, they began to pick some heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, 'Look, why are they doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?' He answered, 'Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar, the high priest, he entered the house of God and ate the consecrated bread, which is lawful only for priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions. Then he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath. Now, the blue, the final piece of the sandwich bread, the bottom piece, you see the fourth story about an interchange with the Pharisees. And again, it's not the disciples now, it's Jesus again, who does something that shocks them. Verse 3. Okay, another time Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Verse 2. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, stand up in front of everyone. Then Jesus asked them, which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts. He said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus. So in sum, these four stories work to show that the Pharisees are not the disciples of Jesus. They can't handle his new wine. It's too much for them. And so they go out to make plans to kill him. So now that we've kind of tackled that big picture, the roadmap of what's going on, I'm going to walk us through this passage, starting in the middle, where the good stuff is, and working outward. And we're going to see three things. First, Jesus is the one who brings the new wine. Second, Jesus' followers drink the new wine. And third, Jesus' new wine makes the Pharisees explode. So hopefully those are memorable as we work through this, right? Jesus brings wine, disciples drink it, Pharisees explode. They cannot handle it. So first, Jesus and the new wine. Look with me at who would at verse 18. That story is where the question is asked that gets into the meat. We'll look back briefly at this story in a few minutes. But listen. Now, John's disciples and the Pharisees are fasting. And some people came and asked Jesus, a legitimate question, how is it that John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees are fasting, but yours aren't? What's up with that? You know, the spiritual bus is passing by, rolling by, and your disciples aren't jumping on the bus. They're missing the spiritual bus. They're not with the holy rollers of the day. Like, what's going on, Jesus? Why are your guys not fasting? And Jesus gives a threefold answer. First, he says that it doesn't make sense for people to fast when the bridegroom has arrived. Now think about it. When you're at a wedding party and the bridegroom strolls in with the bride and they're announced as husband and wife, it's food time, right? I mean, that's usually cue for everybody eat the food because everybody's really eager at that point to eat because they've been taking pictures and it's taken like forever and you're like, all the appetizers are gone and the kids are getting restless. Come on, let's eat already. Now, can you imagine if they were announced, the bridegroom and the bride come in and they come in and they sit down at the head table and somebody grabs, the best man grabs the mic and says, actually, guys, I know you think it's food time, but I actually think we should all just pass on the food, give it to the homeless shelter down the road, and I think we should fast for God. Like, let's make this a time of prayer. Let's be really spiritual here. Okay, you probably hear a pin drop for a minute, and then somebody over in the car is going to be like, boo! Like, no way! That's ridiculous. This is a wedding. We celebrate. You're missing the whole point of this. Like, there is a time to give to the homeless shelter, but it's not right now. Right now is a time where we pick out. We eat a feast. This is wedding time. Throw that guy out. All right, he's missing the point of this day. The wedding is underway. Well, that's Jesus's point. There's a wedding. The bridegroom has come. Now that he's come, it's time to feast. And his answer shows that it's the Pharisees who are actually missing the bus, not his disciples. The wedding bus is going by, and the Pharisees are outside. They're missing the party. Now, if Jesus didn't want people to get the impression that he was God, Well, I don't want to give them the wrong idea. No, if Jesus didn't want to give this impression, he shouldn't have said this whole thing about being a bridegroom coming for his bride. Because in the Bible, throughout the Old Testament, time and again, the Israelite prophets compared Yahweh, God himself, to a bridegroom who's pursuing this rebellious and sinful bride, Israel. His people who are constantly running from him. And the bridegroom is one day going to show up and fix all his people's problems and make them pure and make them love him. And there's going to be a wedding feast and celebration. Okay, and so Jesus, when he says he's the bridegroom, ding, 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 Yahweh is showing up on the scene. Are anyone familiar with the Bible? So Jesus is saying he is God and that he's come to call his people like a bridegroom comes for his bride. And now that he's arrived, it's time to party. There is a time coming, Jesus says, though, when he'll be taken away. And then his people will fast. When's that going to happen? Who's going to come and end the party? Well, if you look down at verse 6 of chapter 3, you find who the party crashers are. It's the Pharisees, who are going to plan to kill the bridegroom because they can't handle his message. Now, this is going to go now to the second thing that we need to see about Jesus' answer. In verse 21, Jesus gives an illustration. He says, you don't put a new patch on an old garment. Has anybody ever put something in the dryer and it's come out way smaller? Hands? Anybody? I put my mom's sweater in the dryer one time, and it came out as like a super dense, heavy kid sweater. Oops, I didn't go over super well. I'm trying to help. Well, Jesus is basically saying that. If you have clothes that are old and worn out and stretched from lots of use, and you put a new patch on it, the new patch is going to shrink. And it's going to rip as it shrinks the edges of the old fabric, and it's going to tear the hole bigger and make it worse. And Jesus is saying, basically, you can't mix the new with the old. The new rips the old apart, just like Jesus' teaching and Jesus' actions are ripping apart the Pharisees and their teaching, as we'll see very soon. And then Jesus gives us a third picture, and this is the one that I used as our main idea about the new wine. Third, Jesus says that people don't put new wine in old wineskins. New wine hasn't finished fermenting yet. What do things do when they ferment? They get bigger. So if you have this old, all stretched out leather wineskin that's already been stretched, and you put new wine in there and it stretches, you're going to lose both the wineskin and the wine. It's gone. Maybe put new wine in new wineskins so that they can expand together. This is something everybody back then knew. What you do? Well, in the same way, Jesus' new teaching and his way of living is blowing up the way that the Pharisees have lived and their teaching. It's expanding and they can't take it. So, Jesus is kind of setting the stage for, explaining basically what's going on in these stories. What's going on is that his teaching and the disciples' actions are, the Pharisees can't handle them because they're clinging to the old way, which brings us to the close of the first point. Jesus brings new wine. Right in the middle of these stories, in the black, that's the main idea. Jesus is the bridegroom, Yahweh, who has showed up for his people, and he brought the new wine that the Pharisees can't handle. Now the next point. Jesus' followers drink this new wine. And by this I mean that they follow Jesus, and in following Jesus, they act in ways that throw off the religious establishment of the day. So in your handout, that's the words in red. First, verses 18 and 20, we'll touch on that quick. They don't fast like the spiritual people of the day. Instead, they're aware that something new has come. The bridegroom of God's people has shown up in the person of God's Son. So we already talked about that. Then,
in verses 23 to 28, the other red section, we read that the disciples cause a commotion when they do something that the Pharisees thought was Sabbath breaking. As Jesus' disciples are walking through a grain field, they're picking the grain and they're rubbing the husks between their hands to crack the husks off, and then they're pulling the pulp out and they're chewing it. Doesn't sound very tasty, but who's quenching their hunger? Now, for years, the Pharisees had taught that doing this on the Sabbath, on the Jewish Sabbath, Saturday, constituted work. The Sabbath was supposed to be a day of rest for Jews, but the law wasn't super detailed on what constituted work. And that's where the Pharisees of Jesus' day stepped in to help. They had the Home Depot model before it was even invented. You can do it. We can help. You need our rules to keep the law. And so they had all these lists of rules. Now, the Pharisees only made up about 1% of the population of Jesus' day. They weren't a huge group. And yet, they were famous for these rules and these regulations. And harvesting grain, even by hand, on the Sabbath, was definitely on the naughty list. It was work. Now, Jesus gives a three-part response. First, Jesus points to one of the stories in the Bible about King David. Would have been a story that was familiar to everybody. And unfortunately, I can't go back there and go into detail about the story. But basically, there's a crisis. And King David and his men are starving, running for their lives from the wicked King Saul. And in this life-threatening situation, King David does something. Jesus' ancestor, the Davidic king, does something that breaks the technicalities of the food laws in the law. He takes bread that was only meant for priests. And so he preserves human life by breaking a technicality about food law. And Jesus says that what David shows is basically human life trumps these little technical food laws. If David did this, though, if the king, David, could do something like this, how much David's greater son? So David's actions are setting precedence for what Jesus goes on to do. And then the second thing Jesus points out was that the Sabbath was made for men. So Jesus is starting to put some logic then under these actions. In other words, the Sabbath was supposed to be a gift for people, a special day for them to rest on, pointing towards the final rest that God would restore to creation one day. It wasn't supposed to be a burden. It wasn't supposed to spark all these hundreds of extra rules to make sure you kept it right. It was supposed to be a day of blessing, a day of longing for God's new creation, when he was going to fix all the toil of this cursed world, and he was going to bring rest, not sleeping around rest, but peace, true rest to his world. It was a day where you could let your hands still and trust that God's hands were still moving. God was providing. God would take care of you even if you weren't up at 5 and to bed at 12 at night. God would provide. And that was the whole point of the Sabbath. It was a gift for man. God didn't create man for the Sabbath, said Jesus. It wasn't like God created, you know, the Sabbath and then thought, boy, I got to have some people to help keep this great day. No, it was a gift for man. And the Pharisees lived like Sabbath keeping was more important than loving people made in the image of God. They acted like a day was more important than the image of God himself. Which brings us to the third thing that Jesus says. Jesus says that the Son of Man, which is one of the ways that he refers to himself, is Lord of the Sabbath. Now again, if Jesus didn't want people to get the idea that he was God, he's not doing very good at it. Who gave the Sabbath? Who is the Lord of the Sabbath? Yahweh. The Israelites know this. And Jesus is saying, I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. The Sabbath belongs to me. And when the Lord of the Sabbath comes, he brings the true rest that the Sabbath only pointed to. Jesus brings the new creation rest in part and fully when he comes again. The Lord of the Sabbath shows up and he brings rest, which is what we see in Jesus' actions that make waves. So we're going to start now moving into the blue Third point, Jesus' new wine makes the Pharisees explode. On your handout, you see Jesus' actions. We'll start with up in verses 13 to 17. We're going to see three things again here. First, Jesus calls a tax collector to follow him. Friends, it's hard for us to imagine today what that must have been like to watch. Tax collectors were the lowest of the low in Jewish society. They were the Jews who worked for the occupying Roman regime, collecting taxes from their fellow Jews. And the Romans didn't pay them anything to do this, so basically, if you were going to be a tax collector, you had to be a crook. Because you had, if you were going to make any kind of living, you had to skim off the top of the pot. Because, if the Romans are asking, 30 shekels of silver from this one person, they want 30 shekels. You better ask 35 or your kids aren't going to eat. So you had to be a crook. It was a lose-lose situation. And these guys would start working and they were desperate. And a lot of them, were just notoriously bad. Not only were they crooks, but there was a whole host of crime and evil that would follow these guys. And nobody liked them. Rome viewed them as useful scumbags. Jews viewed them as terrible neighbors, right? Nobody liked these people. And Jesus walks up to Levi and he says, "Follow me." And Levi obeys. But things get even more startling in verse 15. Jesus eats with Levi and his tax collector friends and sinners, a catch-all category. Now, in those days, eating with somebody was a big deal. It still is a big deal today. It was a sign of fellowship, of friendship. Jesus is literally befriending the worst scumbags in the ancient world. He's befriending them. And as Mark points out, many of them were following him. Now, every society has its view of who the big sinners are. Okay, back then it was the tax collectors. Today, it might be the pimps and the prostitutes and the pedophiles and meth users with their faces just melting away. And Jesus comes and he walks and he befriends them. He sits down with them, the perfect and pure Son of God, the creator of the universe, the strongest and most pure and perfect human being who has ever lived, was eating with the lowest of the low. And the religious people, the people who kept their noses clean all their lives, they despised him. How could he do that? How could he hang out with just these filthy people who are so wicked? And the third thing we see in the story is that Jesus says something amazing. It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. Jesus isn't telling this filthy throng that he's just cool with them staying in sin. You can all just live the way you want. I affirm you. I accept you. And, I just want to be with you because I love you. No, Jesus, that's very foreign to Jesus. That's a modern conception, perhaps, at times. But that is not what Jesus is doing. Jesus is saying, I've come for you because you're sick. You've got a problem. And I'm the doctor. I'm here for you to help you. And here's the amazing thing. When these sick people spent time with Jesus, they were changed. They couldn't just go and be the same. Jesus had touched them, ate with them, affirmed their worth. He befriended them. He knew everything about them, and he loved them. For example, the tax collector Levi would go on. He was renamed Matthew, and he would go on and write the first gospel of the New Testament. He was changed. He left tax collecting, and he became one of the first apostles. And in the New Testament, in the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 13, we read this about Jesus' followers. When they saw, these are the Pharisees, when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished. And they took note that these men had been with Jesus. Jesus had changed them. Later on in chapter 3, we see one of the tasks of a disciple. He appoints 12. And the first part of their task, he appoints 12 to be with him. They were with Jesus. And they were changed. And Jesus is changing sinners today. He's changing me. I've spent time with him, and I've changed. And he can change anyone who comes to him. Jesus has the power to change broken people like you. And we can't come to Jesus though and be the same. You either join his team, or you join those who reject him and who reject the new wine that he brings. So let's move to the second blue section, the last part of this passage. Verses 1 to 6 of chapter 3. In my opinion, this is probably one of the saddest stories in Mark. It takes place in a Jewish synagogue, a place of worship. And there's a man there with a shriveled hand. Maybe you've seen somebody with a hand like that. Shriveled up, hand extended. And the Pharisees are there, and they're watching to see if they can get Jesus to do some healing work on the Sabbath and accuse him of Sabbath breaking. They don't have to wait long. I love this about Jesus. He takes the bait immediately and tells the man to stand up. He's not going to do this little secret healing thing, you know. Let's just keep this on the deal. No. But stand up. He knows what the Pharisees are thinking. He's like, all right, stand up front here. You guys got front row seats of what's about to happen. And then he asks the guys this question. Which is lawful on the Sabbath? What is lawful? To do good or to do evil? To save life or to kill? It's like Jesus is saying, really, guys? It's against the law to do good on the Sabbath? It's against the law to rescue people that are hurting on the day of rest? I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. I've come to bring rest to this poor man. It's against the law to be a burden lifter on God's Sabbath day? And here's the saddest thing about this story. The Pharisees, the good people of society, they're quiet. Their hearts are so hard. And Jesus gets angry, deeply concerned about their lack of concern for human life and for their hardness of hearts. They didn't care a lick about this poor shriveled hand. All they cared about was whether Jesus would break their view of the law, their moral interpretation of what was right or wrong. And Jesus goes right ahead and breaks in front of everybody. And he heals the guy. He says, stretch out your hand. And the guy stretches out his hand. And here's the most chilling part of the story. The Pharisees walk out and they make plans to kill him. Remember Jesus' question? What's lawful on the Sabbath? To save life or to kill? Kill. That's what's lawful. You can't save this guy's life. Oh, you did? Now we're going to cut. We'll show you what's lawful on the Sabbath. We're going to plot to kill the Son of God. And kill him on the Sabbath and prepare to murder God himself. It's just horrifying. Which brings us to the end of these four stories. These religious elite of the day, the Pharisees, they rejected Jesus and they've begun their plot to destroy him. But the sinners, they're following him in droves. The scum of society. The worst people we look at today and say, oh, your kids aren't safe with them. Keep your wallet away from them. They're following Jesus in crowds because they see that they're sick and they need a doctor. When you get sick, where do you go? That's really sick. You go to the doctor. If you don't think you're sick, your wife says or your mom says, oh, I really think you should go to the doctor. You say, oh, I'm not that sick. I don't need a doctor. That's like the Pharisees. They didn't think they were sick. They didn't think they needed Jesus. So there's really, you know, two camps of people. Those who think they need Jesus and those who think they don't. And guys, Jesus came for sinners. And we are all sinners. That's the message of the Bible. The Pharisees show that they're sinners too, right at the end of the story. They're not these righteous extra category people. There's really only one category of people. Sinners. Just some see and some don't. And we're all sinners. But nobody is beneath Jesus. There's nobody who's not worth saving for Jesus. Everybody in society hates tax collectors, but Jesus befriends them. He's a friend of sinners. And it's sinners who know that they're sinners that flock to Jesus. And Jesus, the bridegroom, eats with them. He's like a bridegroom who shows up and picks the ugliest bride that he can find to marry. The one with warts and scabs, the one who's been unfaithful time and again. And Jesus says, I want her. And when she comes to him, she changes. She becomes clean because he makes her clean. And that's what Jesus does for each one of us who turn
to him and repent and believe the good news and receive his sacrifice. But only those who know they're sinners will find him a friend. Only those who are weak and know they're weak will find Jesus mighty to save. Only those of us who know that we are spiritually poor on our own will find Jesus rich with love. If we don't see ourselves as wicked people apart from Jesus, we will never come to Jesus for forgiveness, for true forgiveness. We'll come to him to improve our life, to fix our problems, to make us happy, but we won't come to him for our deepest need, forgiveness from sins. It takes a miracle for those who think they're strong to come to Jesus. Yet strength is an illusion. And the strongest of us will all pass away like grass that's green for a few months and then dies. The tough guys and the tough girls, they all die, just like the wumps and the wusses. They all go to death. Death reminds us that we are weak, but Jesus is strong. He defeated death. In Mark, Jesus goes to the cross and dies for us and rises again. And we need him to rescue us from death and sin and hell. And it's really hard for those who think they're basically pretty good, all-around good people to come to Jesus. Why the heck would I need a Savior if I don't think I'm bad? It's nonsense. It's foolishness. That's why Jesus' gospel makes good people angry. That's why the good people want to kill him. But no one's perfectly good except God, and will always avoid Jesus' call to follow him until we realize we desperately need him to heal us and forgive him, forgive us. We'll always hold back when the gospel is preached until we accept his invitation. I want to eat with you today. I want to sit down with sinners and dine with them. And when we do finally accept that invitation and we receive, you know, Curtis talked about the communion meal. Communion is a profound demonstration of the fellowship of believers, the communion of saints. And one of the things you realize is when you sit down at communion with other believers, you know, you realize, wow, them two more? Wow, really? Them? They're saved as well? Especially newer believers who come to faith in Christ, and sometimes they struggle with this. Like, I know I'm a sinner, and God can forgive my sins, but really? That person? I think I'm going to keep the bread over here. You know, that's not for them. Well, the amazing reality is that Jesus wants us all in the same boat. Because we are all prideful. It just looks different. We are all selfish. It just looks different. We are all full of ourselves and not of him and his spirit. And it just looks different for all of us. Control leads to anger in some and fear and anxiety disorders in others. And I mean, again and again, we see that we are all in the same boat compared to our bridegroom who has come to heal us. We need Jesus and we all need him together. He's come to heal those who realize they're sick. And the Pharisees are the ones who don't see that they're sick. And so we see that there's two kinds of people, right, in Mark's gospel as we come to the close. Those who know they need a doctor and sick people who think they're fine. And the sick people who know they're sick, they follow Jesus. And the sick people who think they're fine, they don't. Jesus has come to rescue sinners. So today, I'm telling you, Jesus calls you all sinners. Every one of you. We are all in the same boat. There is not one of us who is exempt from the label sinners and tax collectors in Jesus' mind. Some of us just look a little more polished on the outside. But Jesus has come, and he calls you, and he calls me to sit down with him, to sit down to the wedding feast. And there is a feast coming one day for all who trust Jesus. A wedding feast called the Supper of the Lamb in the new creation that he is bringing, where the Lord of the Sabbath will come, and he will bring rest, finally. And he will bring rest for sinners who repent. Will you pray with me? Father, I thank you for Jesus who brings rest for sinners, for the doctor who can heal even the worst cases. And I pray, Father, that if there is anyone here who struggles with seeing themselves as sinful, that your Holy Spirit would do a mighty work. Convict of sin and show Jesus to be amazing as a Savior to these people. Show us all, Lord, every day where we need to turn from sin and where we need to cling to Christ. I pray that you would banish from our minds the thought that we're just basically good people who sometimes do bad things. Lord, please help us to see that we are desperate. We are beggars who need Jesus. And I thank you so much that our bridegroom has come. And I pray that as we sing, we would truly celebrate what you have done for us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.